Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of 2016. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members will consult tablets during the course of the meeting as we provide papers in digital format. Apologies have been received today from John Wilson and Cara Hilton. Agenda item one is to decide whether to consider two items in private at this morning's meeting. Item seven is a discussion about the evidence taken as part of an inquiry of the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman. And item eight is a discussion about the evidence taken as part of our scrutiny of the draft budget 2016-17. Are members agreed? Thank you. If we can move on to agenda item two. It's consideration of an affirmative statutory instrument, the Draft Local Authority Capital Finance and Accounting Scotland Regulations 2016. I welcome John Swinney, MSP, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy, and Hazel Black, Head of Local Authority Accounting at the Scottish Government's Local Government Finance and Local Taxation Unit, and Colin Brown, Senior Principal Legal Officer with the Scottish Government. First, we will take evidence in the instrument, and in our next agenda item, the Cabinet Secretary will move the motion for us to recommend the instrument is approved. Mr. Swinney, do you wish to make an opening statement, please?
Thank you, Convener. If I could make an opening statement in relation to these regulations. The local authority's capital expenditure plans, its borrowing plans, and the investment of its surplus money are all interrelated activities. All form part of a local authority's integrated treasury management activities. In 2003, the Local Government in Scotland Act was passed by Parliament, in which Parliament repealed the capital expenditure consent regime and replaced it with a duty for each local authority to determine and keep under review the maximum account it can maximum amount it can afford to allocate to capital expenditure. Provision was made for ministers to regulate in this respect. The 2003 Act also made provision for ministers through regulation to make revised statutory provision as to how local authorities invest their money. Regulations, together with statutory guidance, enable local authorities to determine for themselves where surplus funds may be invested, but require their governance arrangements to be set out in policy documents approved by the authority. For both capital expenditure and investment of money, the statutory provisions require local authorities to have regard to recognised codes. These are the SIPFA Prudential Code and the SIPFA Treasury Management Code. SIPFA is the professional accountancy body for public services. In 2014, as part of the City Deal Agreement, local authorities asked for a review of the legislative provision for local authority borrowing and lending. They sought greater autonomy and responsibility for decisions on borrowing and on the repayment of that borrowing. The Local Authority Capital Finance and Accounting Scotland Regulations 2016, which we are now bringing forward, are the result of work undertaken with local authorities and other stakeholders. These regulations encompass borrowing for capital expenditure and borrowing as a function of a local authority's integrated treasury management activities. The regulations adopt the same approach as for regulating local authority capital expenditure and local authority investment. This sees a local authority be able to determine for itself the source of its borrowing, but in taking these decisions it must have regard to recognised codes. A local authority must also formally determine before each financial year how much external debt it can afford and consider what action to take if that limit is exceeded or is likely to be exceeded. A local authority is also to determine the period over which borrowing, recognised by an advance from the loan fund, is to be repaid to the loans fund and the amount of each repayment. The loans fund is to be administered in accordance with the regulations, proper accounting practices and prudent financial management. Guidance to be issued if Parliament approves these regulations will set out what is considered prudent in terms of repayments to the loans fund. Guidance will also formally identify both the SIPFA Prudential Code and the SIPFA Treasury Management Code as recognised codes in this respect. In summary, Convener, these regulations have been asked for by local authorities and will be welcomed by local authorities. Together with the guidance we will also issue, they will complement and complete the statutory governance arrangements for local authority capital expenditure, borrowing and investments, all of which are interrelated activities. I'd be happy to answer the committee's questions in this respect.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Any questions on this instrument? No. In which case, We move to agenda item three, which is the formal consideration of the motion that this instrument be approved. I'll invite the Deputy First Minister to move motion S4M15459, and the committee has up to 90 minutes to debate the motion with the Cabinet Secretary. Please note that officials may not participate in this debate. After the debate, the committee must make a decision on the motion. Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you to move the motion, please?
I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. Do members wish to enter into debate on the motion? In which case, do members agree to motion S4M1549?
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. Can I suspend very briefly for a change in witnesses, please? Agenda item four is our scrutiny of the draft budget 2016 to 2017. I welcome once again John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy, Graham Owenson, Head of Finance, Scottish Government, and Marianne Cook, Policy Manager, Local Government Finance and Local Taxation Unit of the Scottish Government. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make an opening statement, please?
Thank you, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to meet with the committee to discuss the 2016-17 draft budget, which I presented to Parliament in December. The UK Government's continued austerity programme has reduced Scotland's public finances and put significant pressures on household finances. It is against this backdrop that the Scottish Government has taken its decisions for our budget in 2016-17. Our funding package for local government is focused on delivery of our shared priorities to deliver sustainable economic growth, protect frontline services and support the most vulnerable in our society. The proposals deliver a strong but challenging financial settlement for local government. Scotland's councils are, however, able to address these challenges from a healthy financial base. Local government funding has been protected in Scotland in recent years, with additional resources provided for new responsibilities. This is in stark contrast to the position in England, where local authorities have faced a real terms cut in funding of 27.4% over the four-year period 2011 to 2015. As part of the settlement that the government puts forward, education is a priority for the government. We remain committed to maintaining teacher numbers. We do not believe that cutting the current numbers will benefit pupils' learning. Our commitment is that local authorities should collectively maintain the pupil-teacher ratio at 13.7 and provide a place on the teacher induction scheme to every probationer who needs one. The government will provide £88 million in the settlement to support the delivery of this commitment. Successful health and social care integration will mean that fewer people need to go to hospital to receive care, that they spend less time in hospital and will return home more quickly. We have therefore proposed that £250 million will be provided from the health budget to integration authorities in 2016-17 for social care. £125 million of this funding has been provided to support additional spend on social care, to support the objectives of integration, including to make progress on charging thresholds and to expand capacity as a consequence of demographic change. The other £125 million is provided to help meet a range of cost pressures faced by local authorities in the delivery of effective and high-quality health and social care in the context of reducing budgets. This includes delivery of the living wage for social care workers. As a percentage of estimated total revenue expenditure, next year's reduction in local authority budgets in Scotland, when taking into account the £250 million that will be invested in health and social care, is a reduction of less than 1% of total local authority expenditure. While I do not pretend that this is easy for any council, some of the language used to describe this change has been excessive. The establishment of the Commission on Local Tax Reform followed this committee's recommendation from 2015 on the flexibility and autonomy of local government. The resulting report is a comprehensive piece of work We very much embrace its conclusions, which align with the Scottish Government's overall approach to taxation. We will bring forward before the end of the parliamentary term a detailed plan for reform that will embody the principles of the Commission's report. I urge other parties to do likewise so the electorate is offered informed choices. In the interim, the Scottish Government considers it is important to continue to protect household incomes in what has been a challenging period for them. The final element of the package of measures therefore requires local authorities to work with us to deliver a council tax freeze in 2016-17. We are providing £70 million to enable local authorities to do so. Tough choices have been needed to fund our commitments, such as building innovation to fuel future economic growth in Scotland. In the face of the austerity environment, the lack of full fiscal and economic levers and a declining rate of receipts means it's no longer possible for us to sustain all of our business rate measures. I have announced a number of proposed changes, including to the business rate supplement that large businesses pay and to some other reliefs. The small business bonus scheme, by far the most generous relief for small businesses anywhere in the United Kingdom, will continue in 2016-17. Legislation to make changes will be laid before Parliament later this month. I've also announced a review of the business rate system in Scotland, and more details on that review will be available shortly. I fully understand the pressures on budgets. Our funding proposal protects shared priorities and delivers practical support to intensify the pace of reform. I look forward to creating a settlement that will deliver for communities right across Scotland.
Thank you very much for that, Mr. Swinney. The draft budget describes the local government settlement as strong but challenging. Obviously, local authority leaders have used much stronger language in describing the budget, the local government settlement. Previously, they have stated that the settlement here has fared very well when compared to local government settlements south of the border. After this draft budget, how does local government in Scotland sit with local government compared to local government south of the border when it comes to central government allocation?
Well, there's a substantial difference in the profile of central government support for local authority expenditure. I cited in my statement, in my opening remarks to the committee, that local authority grant support in England had fallen in real terms by 27.4% over the last 4 years. The Scottish Government has taken an approach whereby in each of the financial years since 2011-12, there has been an increase in the resources available to local government, with the exception of the year when we removed police and fire expenditure from local authority budgets, obviously there is a reduction in local authority expenditure in this forthcoming financial year, but as I've explained to the committee in my statement, there is there are mitigation measures that I've put in place to try to support the delivery of local authority services given the challenging financial climate in which we've put in place. So I think the comparison between the performance of funding support for Scottish local authorities has been significantly stronger than for local authorities south of the border, given the long-standing commitment the government has made to effectively support local authority public expenditure.
You have stated, Deputy First Minister, that the allocation to local authorities is a 2% reduction in councils' overall income. And yet we have seen councils like Murray suggest that they need to raise local council tax by 18% to deal with the allocation cut that they feel that they have. Would you like to comment on that 2% reduction in income and the reaction that there's been from councils like Murray?
Well, I acknowledge that there's a £350 million reduction in local authority grant and aid as a consequence of the budget that I have announced. As a proportion of the total expenditure of local authorities, which we estimate to be about £16 billion, that equates to about 2% of a reduction. When we take into account the fact that £250 million is going to be spent through the integrated joint boards to support expenditure that is the expenditure on services in which local authorities are key participants, and given the guidance that I have issued to local authorities as to what they can expect that fund to support, as a proportion of that results in a net reduction in the local authority budget of about £100 million out of £16 billion, which equates to less than 1%. So I think I think some of the talk that we've heard has been, frankly, over the top about the impact of the settlement on local government. I don't underestimate the ongoing challenges in delivering public services within a constrained financial environment. But we have to take into account a whole range of different factors in setting the budget. I have to take into account the degree of pressure there will be on household incomes. I need to take into account the extent of government grant. I have to take into account the constant necessity for us to reform the way in which we deliver public services. And what I have done in relation to the financial support being offered to integrate health and social care is a very substantial investment to assist the process of reform so that services are delivered differently in the years to come than they are currently delivered. So in all, I think the settlement that's been offered to local government is a very credible settlement. I think it certainly does not merit the type of description it has had from certain voices within local authorities, and it most definitely does not merit an 18% increase in the council tax.
Thank you. In terms of that reform, the government during the course of this parliament have talked of a decisive shift to prevention. Is your thinking of creating that fund for health and social care integration to help with that decisive shift to prevention? And there has been some commentary over the course of the weekend from Aberdeen in particular about supposed difficulties in dealing with some aspects of what you require for councils to access the £250 million. I understand that you have said that councils don't have to implement this on 1st of April, but have some leeway in that regard. Would you like to tell us your thinking round about some of these things and maybe comment on what has been said over the course of the weekend?
The purpose, the government is pursuing with our local authority partners and with other public service providers, a long-term agenda, which is to deliver that shift to prevention. I think any analyst would recognise that a shift to prevention does not happen overnight. It takes time for that to be managed and implemented. So the government is taking steps with our partners to advance that that shift to prevention, and the investment of £250 million is designed to do that, because this is an investment which is, as I explained earlier on, is designed to better support individuals to remain in their own homes, where we know that individuals' circumstances and their recovery, if properly supported, will be more effective and more enduring than if they're doing that within an inappropriate care setting, perhaps in a hospital that doesn't meet all of their needs and circumstances at that time. So essentially what we are doing is investing to fuel the capacity and the capability of social care to deliver that preventative agenda and to meet the needs and the expectations of citizens. One of the specific dimensions of the proposition that I have put to local government has been to put in place the measures and the financial support that can ensure that social care workers are paid the living wage. And, you know, if I'd had my preference, I would have wanted to have seen that implemented on the 1st of April, because I think this is an issue which needs to be addressed. I think there's very strong public support for that, very strong parliamentary support for it, and also strong local authority support for the proposition into the bargain. Now, I listened carefully to what local government said to me about this, and I saw no lack of willingness on the part of local government to pursue this issue, but they did present to me some pretty important operational and practical issues and issues of negotiation that would have to be taken forward to make sure that could be implemented reliably. So I accepted that argument and offered a proposition to local government which said that on the previously available funding arrangements, there was no change to the funding arrangement available, that could be implemented with effect from the 1st of October 2016. So care workers would be able to look forward to that proposition being effective by that time. And I think that's a reasonable compromise to recognise the issues that face local government, the very practical issues. And I think it gives every opportunity for some of the points that have been raised in the weekend news coverage, which I found a little bit strange, given the thought that this was, I recognise many local authorities were actually planning to do this anyway, and the government has given some more support to enable that to be the case. I would have thought that was an approach that would have been welcomed within local government.
So obviously some of the perceived barriers there will be round about the Rufert versus Niedersachsen case, which has been much spoken about in this committee previously. Do you think that time frame allows local government to deal with any issues round about that in terms of implementing the living wage for social care workers who don't work directly for councils?
Yes, I think that's adequate time.
Thank you very much. George Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Can I just ask a question? Is it not the case when we're talking about the integration of health and social care that some of the language that's been used by local authorities that you mentioned earlier on, this isn't a surprise for local authorities? This is a plan that they've been working towards for a number of years, for quite a while now. And the whole idea is that we can actually get to a place where, when you look at the human element in the whole system, where social care and health are integrated in such a way that the individuals that are dealing with it right at the front, at the health and social care part, they're actually getting the service that they actually need, instead of getting caught between two big, almost in certain cases, conflicting the institutions, whether it be health and the local authority themselves. So is it not just a case that the local authorities knew this was going to happen and it's no big surprise to them?
Well, certainly we've been in very active negotiation with local government, in a partnership way, for the implementation of health and social care integration. I think the debate on this question has been going on for, well, I think the debate's probably gone on as long as I've been a member of this Parliament, which is from its founding days. And what I'm pleased about is that we've got to the point that we have now legislated for integration, for health and social care integration at local level, and the arrangements are in their shadow year, ready for implementation on the 1st of April. What I recognise is that in the bringing together of these services, there will undoubtedly be opportunities for us to deliver services in a more effective way that addresses some of the questions of duplication, which address some of the issues of the significant management of caseload that goes on as individuals make their journey through the care system. Because I think the point that Mr. Adam is getting at in his question is the correct point, which is members of the public, and particularly their families, want to see individuals getting the support that they require. They're not particularly interested in who provides it, as long as it's provided and it is of the recognised quality of service. So what health and social care enables us to do is to more adequately address the needs of individuals, and also to remove the barriers and obstacles and duplication that can often exist in the provision of services. Now, the new partnerships will be managing about £8 billion of health and social care resources between them, and we've put in an extra £250 million to drive that process of reform yet further. So within an £8 billion budget, I am absolutely certain there is an opportunity for us to deliver care services much more effectively, much more efficiently, that can create more capacity and, most importantly, meet the needs and the interests of individuals. And I would say that the collaboration that's gone on with local government in the formulation of the legislation on health and social care and on its implementation has been welcomed by the government and has been beneficial for citizens.
Can I just also on that point, you know, on shared services in general and local authority. Now, my time as a councillor, I'd heard on numerous occasions that we're going to work more innovatively as a council, we're going to share services, we're going to move things forward. And even now, we have a situation where when I'm on the Education Committee, I've asked members of COSLA and various other kind of councils as well that were there giving evidence, asking them, you know, have you looked at innovation, ways that we can use back-of-house services, how we can actually kind of work together in a local authority, by local authority way in education or other ways. You know, have local government, how does this budget help local government in that context, and how has local government worked towards the shared services, you know, to try and make sure that they can actually not just make efficiencies, but like health and social care integration, actually deliver service in an efficient and helpful way?
There are two points I'd make in relation to Mr. Adams' question. The first is about innovation. We have to, in my wider responsibilities within government, I am encouraging the formulation of what has been described as a culture of perpetual innovation within Scotland. And that has to, I think innovation is often viewed just now, I think, as the preserve of sophisticated technologies and higher education institutions. Innovation has to be the preserve of all of us. And particularly within the public services, we need to find new and different ways in which we can exercise our responsibilities and find solutions to the needs of individuals. So I would encourage local government to consider, and there are many, many good examples of this within the field of prevention, which the convener questioned me about a moment ago, where local authorities are demonstrating very good measures that tackle the issue of prevention. The second point I would make is in relation to the wider issue around shared services, where I don't for a moment believe that we have exhausted all possible avenues for the delivery of shared services. We still have councils habitually working independently and without collaborating on particular questions and the provision of particular services. So there is an opportunity for that to be achieved, and of course that's another device and technique that can be used to meet the budget challenges faced by local authorities.
Okay, George. Jane Baxter, please.
Thank you, Convener. Morning. I want to ask about the £250 million transfer from the NHS to the Integrated Joint Boards. Is there going to be a mechanism in there to ensure that that money continues to be additional and that councils can't reduce their contribution as a result of that new money coming in?
What I've said is that the local authorities have, in their participation within integrated joint boards, can essentially offset increases in the costs of their provision of health and social care services. So every year, social care costs will increase to continue the existing service that is provided. I've indicated to the local authorities that they can assume that £125 million of the £250 can be used to assist them in meeting the additional costs that arise out of providing the existing service. And that within that, there are resources to pay the living wage to social care workers. And then I've also said that £125 million must be allocated to provide additional support. So essentially, if a new care package requires to be provided by a local authority, it is, in my view, entirely legitimate for that to be paid for out of £125 million of the new resources going in. Because there will be, we all know, there are, on an annual basis, there will be more care packages required from one year to another. So there is provision for additionality and there is provision to meet the increased costs of providing the existing care service that is provided by local authorities, but albeit it will be provided within the environment of the Integrated Joint Board.
Okay, thank you. That's good. Okay.
Will a coffee, please?
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In some of your opening remarks, you gave us some of the figures that are on the table here. I wonder if you could kind of broadly outline for us what the funding settlement to Scotland has been over the last spending review period, just to put that in contrast with what local authority settlements have been during that period as well. I want to get an indication or an idea of what's happening in countries like Scotland and England and Wales in terms of settlements for local authorities compared to the overall allocations that we get.
Well, essentially, over the period from 2010 to 2020, so that's over the term of the last Conservative Liberal coalition when the austerity programme started in 2010 to the end of this current Conservative term in office, the discretionary budget available to the Scottish Government will have fallen by 12.5% in real terms compared to 2010-11. So the real terms reduction is essentially the equivalent of £1.08 being lost from the Scottish Government's budget. I don't have to hand a directly comparable local authority funding position in Scotland over the entirety of that period, but between 2008-09 and 2015-16, local government funding in Scotland has reduced by 4.4% in real terms. So those are not directly comparable years that I can offer to Mr. Coffey, but I think it does show that the Scottish budget has been declining sharply, and we have worked to protect local authority expenditure during that period.
You mentioned a cut, though, I think, in your remarks of something like 27.4% given to English local authorities, I think, in the period from 11 to 15. I mean, even if you don't have the immediate figures there, I mean, are you saying that the cut to Scotland, the equivalent, is about 4% compared to 27% given to the English local authorities?
It's not directly comparable in those years, but the reduction in Scotland has been significantly lower than the reduction in the rest of the United Kingdom.
Okay. And you gave some figures for England there, but as I understand it, in Wales, for example, the cut proposed this year to local government is about 2%, which the Welsh First Minister described as councils there being relatively well protected. But the narrative in Scotland has been hysterically the opposite of that, where your cut of around 1%, you see, has been described as a disaster and so on and so forth. Would you like care to comment on the contrasting approach taken in the two countries to what looks like fairly similar levels of funding for the local authorities in both Scotland and Wales, but the different approach and narrative being given to both?
See, if I look at the period since 2011-12, in 2012-13, the government's support to local government increased by 0.43%. We then had 13-14 where we removed the costs of police and fire, so there was a fall in that year, but that would be expected because we removed those costs. In 14-15, the local government budget went up by 3.62% in Scotland. It then went up by 2.15% in 2015-16. So there's two points I think that are relevant about the local government budget in Scotland in comparison to the situation that Mr. Coffey has outlined. One is that local government is starting from a relatively high base. If I look back at the settlements that I've delivered over the years to local government, the local government base has been getting stronger and stronger year by year. So it starts off from a higher base. And secondly, the scale of the reduction in the local government budget in Scotland is smaller, much smaller, than some of the changes that have been applied to other public bodies within Scotland. And when we take into account all relevant factors, including the injection of 250 million into integrated joint boards, the reduction for local government in terms of their overall expenditure, because it's not just government grant that supports local authority services, it's council taxes, other charges and other factors, the reduction is less than 1%. So I think there's I think we have to see this in its proper context, and I think some of the language that has been used to describe the settlement has been, in my view, absolutely inappropriate in trying to explain what has happened. And I appreciate that there are challenges in the local government settlement, but there's challenges in every part of the budget. You know, the health service budget is going up, but there are challenges within the health service because of rising demand. And I think that needs, that proper context has to be understood.
Of course, John Swinney can only dish out the cake that John Swinney gets to dish out. It's not nasty Mr. John Swinney that's deciding to impose these cuts. You're dealing with a financial settlement being given to you by the Treasury in the UK.
I am, and there are choices to be made around that, which I suspect will be the substance of some of the issues we discuss in the chamber this afternoon in relation to stage one of the budget process. But there are obviously powers that I have where I can change the amount of income that we make. I've taken those decisions, difficult decisions in relation to business rates, to increase business rates, to ensure that we have more resources at our disposal to support non-domestic rates. I've obviously made a choice that I want to protect household incomes, particularly for low-income households that have been under severe pressure since 2008-2009. And I don't think that the evidence in front of me indicates anything other than there remains significant challenges for household incomes, and I've decided therefore not to increase the Scottish rate of income tax, which would place that burden on low-income households within Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Could I ask you about the council tax freeze as well? Some members of the public think that a council tax freeze means that the council's budget is frozen as well. Some do think that there's a tightness there that's being applied by the government, which means that the council's budget's frozen, but that's not the case. I think you've outlined again in your remarks that the councils are funded to achieve that freeze year on year. Could you just clarify, has that been the case? So
the government has built into each local authority settlement since 2008-09 £70 million to pay for the council tax freeze. Now, of course, that is set essentially at an assumption of inflation at 3%, and I've never changed that number. And I think the analysis that was produced by Spice some months ago indicated that, I'll quote from that report. It said that it could be said that the council tax freeze over the period 2008-09 to 2013-14 was overfunded, with an estimated £164.9 million extra going to local government as a result. So there were years in which inflation was lower than 3%, but I maintained the £70 million going into local government to pay for the council tax freeze. And the Spice report rather indicates that that has been adequately and effectively funded by the government over that period.
And could I finally ask just about the proposal to local councils, Cabinet Secretary? I think you mentioned three key proposals as part of the settlement. Could you clarify again what the arrangements are in relation to the three proposals that you've been made to local councils, and whether they have now all agreed and signed up to that offer made by the Scottish Government?
What I've set out to local authorities, and I did this in a final offer letter on the 27th of January to the President of COSLA, which was copied to all the leaders of all local authorities in Scotland, was essentially a proposition which set out the funding available authority by authority, but required local authorities invited local authorities to participate in accessing £408 million of resources that would fund three things: the investment of £250 million in the integration of health and social care activities at local level, secondly, the maintenance of the teaching population through the mechanism of the pupil-teacher ratio be maintained at a value of 13.7 across all local authorities. And I would stress that local government made representations to me that they did not want an authority-by-authority arrangement, which we had for 2015-16, and I have acceded to that and have moved to a national picture of maintaining the pupil-teacher ratio at 13.7. And then finally, the council tax freeze, upon which Mr Coffey has just questioned me. So I indicated to local authorities that by the 9th of February, I invited them to indicate if they were prepared to participate in that package of funding of £408 million. I've made it clear to the local government that it is a requirement that they participate in all three elements. It's not possible for authorities to pick one or more. They must participate in all three. I've indicated, however, that at a later stage in the year, if an authority doesn't perform effectively against each of these elements, I reserve my right to claw back some of the resources associated with that topic. So, for example, if a local authority signs up to protect teacher numbers but in fact doesn't do so, I would reserve my right to claw back a proportion of the £88 million that's involved in the settlement in relation to teacher numbers. I have subsequently had correspondence from the leader of Moray Council, which has asked me if the scenario that if a local authority was to sign up to all three elements of the package, and then subsequently at budget setting date, which would be within the next few weeks, they decided not, for example, to freeze the council tax, would I just penalise them in relation to the council tax, or would I withdraw the support, their share of the £408 million, the total package of support available? And I've taken the opportunity of that scenario to clarify to all local authorities that if an authority told me on the 9th of February that they were going to sign up to all three elements, but then a couple of weeks later decided to increase the council tax, I would consider that to be an act of bad faith, and I would withdraw the funding in relation to the whole £408 million. So I've communicated that to the leader of Moray Council and to all local authority leaders, just to avoid any lack of clarity on what my intention would be. And obviously, I've now placed that on the parliamentary record, which will have some significance in the consideration of local authorities.
The point you're making, though, is that you're funding these three elements. You're actually giving the local councils the funding to deliver on these three. So it would seem pretty strange if they accepted the funding and then didn't carry out the policy.
That's the point I've made in my letter of 27th of February to local authority leaders, and in the subsequent letter dated the 29th of, the letter of the 27th of January to Councillor O'Neill, and the letter that I've sent to the leader of Moray Council, copied to leaders of all Scottish local authorities on the 29th of January. And if it would help the committee, I'm very happy to make a copy of that letter available to the committee for the benefit of its records.
Extremely useful, Deputy First Minister.
Cabinet Secretary, thank you.
Deputy First Minister, the draft budget shows that non-domestic rates income is forecast to fall by 2.8% in real terms in 2016-17. Could you maybe outline the reason for that predicted fall in non-domestic rates income? And can you maybe give us an indication of how much the large business supplement and changes to reliefs are expected to raise too, please?
Essentially, the issues that have affected the non-domestic rates pool have been twofold. Levels of inflation, when we were making our predictions, and we make long-term predictions about the level of non-domestic rates, we made assumptions about the level of inflation that would be prevalent, and we generally use the Office for Budget Responsibility estimates of likely inflation. As we all know, inflation has been significantly lower than the OBR estimates, so that has obviously affected the expectations that we could have achieved in terms of the increase in non-domestic rates receipts. The second issue is that buoyancy estimates have the level of buoyancy that's been delivered has not been as high as was anticipated in the budget, in the budget assessments. For example, in 2014-15, we assumed a buoyancy level of 1.55%, but the actual buoyancy for 2014-15 was 0.82%. And of course, there is a cumulative impact of some of those factors on the receipts for non-domestic rates. So what I've had to do is to take steps to improve the strengthening of the non-domestic rates pool, and that's what has transpired in relation to the decisions I have made on different elements here. The large business supplement is estimated to raise £60 million as a consequence of the decisions that I've taken. And I think for the benefit of the committee, I should perhaps put this change into some context. What I have decided to do is to increase the large business supplement from 1.3 pence to 2.6 pence. And that gets added on to the 48.4 pence, which is the core poundage that is paid by all businesses, or all business, to which all businesses are liable. The combination of those two factors increases business rates for companies that pay the large business supplement by 3.4% for 2016-17. If I go back to recent years, in 2011-12, the comparable increase for companies paying the large business supplement was 4.6%. And in 2012-13, it was 5.8%. So although the increase is slightly higher than the increase would be for ordinary companies who are not paying the large business supplement, I think within the context of the last few years, the increase of 3.4% is not even as high as the increases that have taken place in 2011-12 and 2012-13.
Thank you. If I could move on to small business. In my own constituency, as I go out and about, the small business bonus scheme has been welcomed by almost every small business owner that I've come across in recent times, with many folks saying that it's allowed them to keep their heads above the water in tough times, or has allowed them to invest. Yet there seems to be, in certain quarters, a call for the small business bonus scheme to be abandoned. What's the government's position on that, please, Mr. Swinney?
The government's position is that we believe the small business bonus scheme has been of enormous benefit in a very challenging financial climate for small businesses of the length and breadth of the country. And indeed, we now see from the latest statistics that just short of 100,000 properties have seen their business rates either reduced or completely removed by the small business bonus scheme. For the sake of accuracy, the number at the last statistical release was 99,559. And that's an increase of 3,000 since last year. That can save companies up to £3,200 more than equivalent businesses south of the border. So it shows a real competitive advantage for small companies within Scotland. And I think the government has made clear our belief that this is a really fundamental element of the architecture of financial support to the business community within Scotland, and if we are fortunate to be re-elected in May, we will maintain that scheme in the years to come. Since the introduction of the Small Business Bonus Scheme, about £1 billion has been invested in small businesses through the Small Business Bonus Scheme, so it's been a very significant contribution. And given the challenges that I think all members will face in their constituencies, the challenges of the sustainability of town centres and wider challenges for the business community, I think this has been very strong support that's been welcomed by members of the public and the business community.
So the government believes that that's £1 billion well invested?
It does.
Can I ask you about any local authorities that plan to use the localised relief under the Community Empowerment Act? Are you aware of any authorities that have made moves in that front?
I think it's quite early for that to materialise, Convener. The provisions would have had Royal Assent in... Royal Assent would have been forthcoming just within the last 6 months. So the power came into effect on the 1st of October, so it's quite early for us to see the steps that authorities may be taking. But I think it's what I've tried to do is to do two things on non-domestic rates for local authorities. One, to give absolute certainty to local authorities about the financial support they can rely on from non-domestic. Well, actually, three things. Reliability from the financial support that's available to local authorities from non-domestic rates. Secondly, we have a situation where the non-domestic rates raised in every local authority area goes directly to that local authority. So in your own city, Convener, all of the business rates raised within the City of Aberdeen flow directly to the City of Aberdeen Council. And I think that's as it should be. And then thirdly, I've given local authorities the opportunity, where they see fit, to use their resources to reduce business rates if they believe that would be beneficial to the local economy. And I, of course, encourage local authorities to consider the use of those powers. I would also point out, Convener, finally, that these powers have come into effect in Scotland significantly earlier than they have come into effect south of the border. We don't expect these powers to come into effect in the rest of the United Kingdom until 2020, but they came into effect in Scotland in October 2015. I think it may even have been the 31st of October. I think I better check my... I think I'll correct the record on that.
So not so long ago that that came into being. So we may see some changes in forthcoming local authority budgets.
Options will be available to local authorities to do that.
We'll
if they
watch
so
that
choose.
With interest. Obviously, as part of our budget scrutiny this year, the committee has focused on city deals and local government pension funds and their use in investing in infrastructure projects. Apart from the fact that Aberdeen has now received its city deal information, do you have any anything to update us on in terms of city deal allocations or local government pension funds investing in infrastructure projects, Deputy First Minister?
Obviously, I welcome the fact that we have managed to reach agreement with the City of Aberdeen Council on the city deal and with the United Kingdom Government. And that was, of course, announced last week by the Prime Minister and a jointly signed by the Secretary of State for Scotland and Keith Brown and the leaders of Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire Councils, and supported by Serene Wood, who has made a huge contribution to this discussion and with whom I will be meeting later on today. So the Aberdeen deal is in place and we look forward to implementing that. It is of course supported by a wide range of Scottish Government expenditure in the northeast of Scotland in relation particularly to the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route and of course the other examples of investment that the Scottish Government set out in relation to improving journey times and capacity on key links between Aberdeen and the Central Belt and the rail services, the improvement of the Lawrencekirk Junction and the expansion of the digital connectivity services that we plan and the expansion of housing services. So I think there's a very strong and emphatic deal for the northeast of Scotland in that respect. There are further discussions being taken forward just now in relation to the city deal in Inverness, and that is, I would think, the next most advanced proposition, and there are other discussions that are underway in relation to other propositions, and of course the Government will keep the Committee and Parliament updated on these questions. In relation to the investment of, by pension funds, we are seeing increased interest and energy being put behind the whole concept of pension fund investment in infrastructure, and we are actively involved in discussions to enable that to be taken forward by different local authorities.
Thank you very much. Obviously, you can't appear in front of this committee without me asking you about the funding formula in terms of the allocation of funds to local authorities. Has there been any moves from COSLA in recent times to change that funding formula?
Nothing, convener, other than the routine updating of indicators that will be undertaken jointly between the government and COSLA through the Settlement and Distribution Group, which essentially looks at updated and changed factors, but no fundamental reform of the distribution formula arrangements.
You've gone on record before, Deputy First Minister, as saying that you were more than willing to review the funding formula if COSLA approached you and asked you to do so. Is that still the case?
That remains my position, Convener.
Thank you. Can I ask you if the Scottish Local Government Partnership has approached you in terms of changing the funding formula at all?
I saw a letter last night that I received from the Scottish Local Government Partnership, which I haven't had the opportunity to consider all of its details. With the caveat that I'm not familiar with all of its contents, although it's just been put in front of me. I think the details of this do not relate to reviewing the funding formula, and I'm unaware of having received representations to do so. But I think in the interests of absolute accuracy, I better just check all correspondence in that respect and reply to the committee in writing. But I'm not aware of any call for a review of the distribution mechanism.
We'd be grateful to receive that in writing. Will I coffee, please?
Just on that issue about the funding formula, Cabinet Secretary, as I understand it, one of the main ingredients in this mysterious funding formula is population size within the authorities. And if you look at the data and the revenue allocations to the authorities, but on a per head basis, you get a completely different picture. For example, on a per head basis, Glasgow City's allocation is actually 113% of the Scottish average. And my own authority, East Ayrshire, has slightly increased too. So while authorities wait with bated breath about the allocation that they get, if you're looking at these allocations on a per head basis, it's a different story to tell. So is that, do you know, is that within the thinking of COSLA to, at some point in the future, have some kind of higher regard or closer regard to the population element of the local authorities in terms of the settlements they should get finally?
The funding formula is a combination of certainly population factors, and the population issues bear very heavily on the distribution formula, but there are a range of other indicators that are that borne in mind, which do not relate to population and take into account some of the differences in the nature and the character of local authority areas and the special circumstances to which we have to address. Clearly, Mr. Coffey is absolutely right, there is a very significant range in the per capita funding that is received by local authorities. The Scottish average is £1,776. Glasgow City, for example, is £2,222. And Mr. Coffey's area in East Ayrshire is £1,872. So there will be a range, and that will reflect the intensity of population, and it will reflect the nature and the challenges of individual localities as affected by a range of different issues.
But at the moment, there's no imperative within COSLA to change the formula?
No. I would have to say I've had... It's one thing I've been pretty clearly heard from local government that there hasn't been much of an appetite to revise the funding formula. And indeed, at particular times, I have been expressly asked not to do so.
Thank you very much for that. And finally, on the funding formula, I take it the government's position is to keep the funding floor in place.
It is, yes.
Cabinet Secretary, Deputy First Minister, can I thank you for your evidence to the committee today? I understand that you're off to the Finance Committee now. Thank you. I suspend briefly for a change in witnesses. Okay. Our next agenda item, number five, is to consider the following negative statutory instrument. That's the Local Government Pension Scheme Scotland Amendment Number 2, Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/448. Members will see from the clerk's note this instrument makes a number of updates to existing regulations, enabling payment of survivor benefits to survivors of same-sex marriages, and I prefer the term equal marriage myself, and provision for new shared parental leave. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has drawn the Parliament's attention to a technical issue concerning a definition which the Scottish Government has undertaken to resolve. Do members have any comments? Is the committee content to agree it has no recommendations to make to Parliament in relation to this instrument? Are members agreed? Thank you very much. We now move on to agenda item six, where we'll be taking evidence from the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman as part of our annual inquiry. I welcome Jim Martin, Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, Nikki McLean, Director, Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, Paul McFadden, Head of Complaints Standards at the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, and Emma Gray, Head of Policy and Communications at the SPSO. Would you like to make an opening statement, Mr. Martin, please?
No, convener. I think you've got a busy enough agenda without me going on as well. So I'd be perfectly happy to expand on any of the materials that we've sent to you and to take any questions the committee may have.
Okay, thank you very much. I actually had the pleasure of being able to speak to Mr. McFadden and Ms. McLean at yesterday's meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee. First of all, could you maybe give us an indication of how the added responsibilities that you're about to undertake from the 1st of April as regards the appeals process for the Scottish Welfare Fund, how that will affect the service that you provide, Mr. Martin?
Happy to, Convener. The Scottish Welfare Fund provision is being funded by the Scottish Government, and I'm happy with the funding of that, and I'm happy with the resourcing of that. I'll ask Paul McFadden perhaps to tell the committee a little about the practicalities of the implementation from April 1. Paul?
Yes, thank you. As the committee are aware, this does bring a slightly different role for the Ombudsman in terms that we'll have a role to direct local authorities in terms of decisions that are made in terms of the Welfare Fund. So a lot of our preparations have been around taking into account how we will adapt our process to take account of that different role. Also in terms of the timescales, clearly the circumstances which people applying for the fund find themselves in mean that quick and robust decisions are absolutely crucial. So we're having to design a process to cater for that and make sure we get responses out quickly within one day or 21 days in the case of community care grants. From the very early stages that this was proposed, I think the uncertainty around what the numbers may be has been something which has been a bit of a concern for us and a bit of a hindrance in terms of planning. In the first years of the Welfare Fund and the current scheme, the review numbers were particularly low compared to the previous scheme that existed, IRS, where it was up to 6,000 for Scotland. We're looking at quite a significant increase on Tier 2 reviews at local authority level over the last few years. We're estimating that is now going to be in the region of 1,000, maybe 1,200, but there is a big unknown there. So that is something that we're having to kind of plan for. We have in place a team. We've recruited a team that will start shortly. We're preparing a detailed training programme for them. I think most importantly throughout all of this process has been an engagement with both the third sector advocacy and support agencies and local authorities. We've set up sounding boards for each of these groups, and they've been a great help and support as we've developed this, as we've prepared ourselves for taking on the role from 1st of April.
And I take it that you've done everything possible to simplify the design and the operation of the complaint handling system, because obviously these complaints have to be dealt with quite quickly because folk are in crisis.
Absolutely. Simplicity of access and the speed of our decisions are absolutely at the forefront of everything we are doing. And I think within that crisis grants, clearly those who are applying in crisis situations, they will always be prioritised over anything else that comes into our office. And we're looking to request information from local authorities within 24 hours. And once we've received all information, make our decision within one day on crisis grants. So, yes, absolutely.
Thank you. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you. Good morning. Last year, you raised evidence about the complaints for health and integration of health and social care. I just wondered how much progress has been made in this towards integrating the complaint handling, which was key, and you expressed, I think, last year some reservations on it.
Mr. Martin, please.
I think there's been significant progress in that, and I think I'm very grateful to this committee for putting its shoulder behind the arrangements, because I felt like a voice crying in the wilderness for a very long time. And once the committee began to get involved and take a serious interest in this, things started to move quickly. I think we're on course now to have an integrated approach between the social side and the health side. One of the things that we are currently doing with the National Health Service is bringing their complaints process onto the same footing, the same complaints handling procedures as we have for other parts of the public sector. And that will enable complaints to be dealt with through the same simple process as before. Once again, Paul McFadden has been leading on that work through the Complaints Standards Authority. Paul, is there anything you want to add to that?
No, I think just to put on record, our thanks to the committee who obviously looked at this issue in some detail, and I think we did see progress quite quickly after that. In terms of getting the legislative or the path to the legislative changes put in place for that simple standard process across all of the areas within integration, integrated social health and social care, I think clearly there's quite a bit to go. I think April 2017 is the date by which we'll have the NHS process, social work process, and the integration joint boards themselves operating from the same process. So a lot of work is ongoing with those partnerships and those boards and those involved within the process to make sure that this is well prepared for.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments about the committee as well. I think we'll probably have something about that in our legacy paper, Cameron.
Yes, I was just going to ask, you did mention that, I think with these complaints, speed is of the essence, isn't it, particularly with involved with health. Are you satisfied that it is being handled speedily or reasonably speedily?
I think we're getting there. I do think we're getting there, and I'm very impressed by the progress that's been made, particularly in the National Health Service, towards moving to a single complaints handling process based on the CHPs that we have. So, yes, at the moment, I'm reasonably content with that.
Thank you. That's fine.
Could you give us an idea of what specific ways the SPSO consider that you've demonstrated over the period that you've provided value for money and added value in the work that you're carrying out? Mr. Martin?
Yeah, it depends what the period is.
Well, let's deal with the year.
Okay, let's deal with this year. And which means, Convener, I will set aside the fact that through implementing the Sinclair recommendations for a single complaints body in Scotland and by absorbing things like prisons complaints, water complaints, we year on year are saving the public purse £1.5 million by absorbing these within the SPSO. Over this year, I think that the progress that has been made in bringing together improved complaint handling procedures across the public service in Scotland is frankly worth its weight in gold. You'll see from our strategic plan evidence that we, and the update we gave on the 9 months progress this year, that for the first time we're able to compare year-on-year numbers, for example, in local government for complaints being brought in. And you'll see that it is now possible to say that, for example, at the first stage of local authority complaints in Scotland, there's been an increase in the number of complaints upheld from 50% to 70% by local authorities. Now, that should enable local authorities in Scotland and this committee to begin to ask the question, well, why is that? Is it that we're getting better at dealing with the complaints that people bring? Or is it that there is a problem with the services that we've been provided? So in that way, we bring some value add. We've made over 1,000 recommendations for improvements in public services through health, local government, prisons, water, throughout the last year. Each of these recommendations either brings some comfort to people who have had things go wrong, for example, in the National Health Service, by bringing apologies for poor treatment, or they have been recommendations which have been accepted for improving processes and the way that people are dealt with in the public sector. So I'm pretty confident that for £3 million spend, which is what is spent on the SPSO, there's far more than that value coming back every year.
In terms of those 1,000 recommendations for improvement that you've mentioned there, Mr. Martin, how do we ensure that those recommendations are acted upon? And how do we make certain that those recommendations are known by other public bodies who may actually need to improve also?
First thing is, I know the committee took some time to look at some of our recommendations in detail, and happy to discuss that process with you, and I welcome that. One of the things that we do is we never sign off that a recommendation has been completed unless we have looked very, very carefully at the evidence that's brought to us by the public body to whom we've made the recommendation. So we don't give carte blanche to anybody. You'll see in our strategic plan that one of the things that we are intent on doing is creating a learning and improvement unit. Part of its role will be to follow through on recommendations. I'm going to ask Nicky McLean in a second, convener, to talk maybe a bit more about that. But one thing I would ask the committee, I've got about a year to go as Ombudsman, so I'm starting to kind of put down markers. One of the things I think the committee has rightly done is look at what is the impact One of the most frustrating things for an ombudsman sitting in my position is not being able to follow through when we see a number of individual complaints were about the same issue. The Act which set up the Ombudsman, the SBSO Act in 2002, which was revised in 2010 after a review, tells me that I can only look at individual complaints that are brought to me. I think that is a waste of a public resource. I think where there are issues, systemic issues, that the Ombudsman should be encouraged to raise these systemic issues and investigate them. If I can give you an example, and I know this is a long answer, convener. In one hospital, we had five different complaints come to us over a relatively short period of time, where cancer diagnoses had been missed in radiography. Now, technically, I could look at each of these only in isolation and come to a decision on the merits. But once you've seen four or five of these things, you begin to think there's a systemic issue. And there are two ways that you can deal with that. You can either informally, through back channels, raise this with the appropriate bodies, which we do, or on the back of one of the complaints, you can put a recommendation which goes to the systemic issue. I think Scotland would be better served if the Ombudsman were able to flag up that a number of issues in the same area had been spotted and that the Ombudsman then intended to conduct a systemic investigation into these issues. But I may say more about that next year when I'm here, which will be my last appearance. Perhaps Nicky McLean might talk about the Learning and Improvement Unit convener, which I think the committee might be interested in.
I thank you for that, Mr. Martin. There's absolutely nothing to prevent you from raising systemic issues with this committee or with others of the Parliament. And obviously, in your previous answer, you pointed out where the committee has been helpful to you in terms of dealing with the complaint system for the integrated health and social care system. Is there a reticence sometimes for you maybe to come here to Parliament with some of these things so that, you know, we can undertake investigation and inquiry if there is some real difficulty in a particular area of public service?
No reticence, convener, but I'm always conscious of the legislation under which I have to operate, which sets out quite clearly what I may and may not do. And I think that bringing issues to committees of the Parliament is a very good and valuable way of getting things done. I mean, we only have to look at your involvement in the health and social care complaints system to see that that can work. I'm thinking it more in terms of having to move quickly and directly on issues, like the one I gave about radiography departments in a hospital, and enabling the very, very good people that I have working with me to bring their expertise to bear to look at whether or not there are systemic issues as well. So I don't see the two in competition. I think they can run parallel.
Yeah. In terms of, let's stick with this example that you've given. In terms of your recommendations there about the separate cases, who at the health board would your findings go to? Who all would be in receipt of your findings?
I think that's one of the improvements that we've made in the last couple of years, particularly in health. On the back of the mid-staffs inquiry down south, the Robert Francis inquiry, where it became perfectly clear that one of the reasons that a number of people, number of the things that happened, some people died, what Francis identified was that these could have been prevented had the board or the trust in England and the chief executive and the chair in particular taken the complaints process seriously. In the NHS in Scotland over the last couple of years, the governance arrangements for dealing with complaints is a lot better than it was 3 or 4 years ago. It's now taken very, very seriously indeed. So to that extent, I'm happy that there is visibility of individual cases being brought to boards. But sometimes things happen in an individual board or they happen between different boards that are missed because they're only seen in the time that they're presented. Whereas where we sit, we tend to see these things and can identify them a lot more simply. Now, in some cases, boards will grasp with two hands when we say to them, we think you've got a systemic issue. and I include local authorities in that as well. In other cases, people will point out to me the limits of my legislation and what it is that I am permitted to do and not permitted to do.
Basically, you're limited here in what you can do. Deny you interfere. Is that what we're hearing from you there?
I'm not going to name names, Convener, but that has been said to me, but not often as politely as you have put it. Basically, it's you're straying beyond your powers. Your powers limit you to do this, this and this. If Scotland is going to still be in the forefront of developing the Ombudsman Service, and we recognise internationally as being there, that this Parliament's created it, you're going to have to free up the next Ombudsman to be able to look at these issues.
I think it would be very interesting for the committee to catch sight of documentation of where folk think that you have overstepped your powers. And then, you know, we could then look at what situations they've found themselves in before they've reached the point of saying to you that you've overstepped your powers. In terms of the systemic thing, because I don't think we should drift away from that, you know, if I was an individual member of a health board and the same kind of complaint was cropping up again and again and again, surely it would be my duty to delve further into that, and surely I should be grateful for the Ombudsman for pointing these things out. Do folk not feel that way?
I think one of the things that we've introduced this year, which I think will help certainly individual boards join up the dots, is we've introduced within our annual letters to all health boards a learning and improvement statement. So we've asked for all bodies under jurisdiction in our largest sectors to sign up to say that they have indeed carried out that kind of analysis, so they're not just looking at individual cases on a piecemeal basis, but they do try to identify systemic issues, and that they confirm to us that they've done that. So that's a part of the process that we've introduced this year.
Mr. Martin, you look like you were wanting to come back in there. No?
No. I think Nicky summed it up very well.
Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you again. Could I continue this wee discussion about systemic issues? I used to be a member of the Audit Committee, and in a previous life spent some time as a quality manager and so on. This kind of the golden holy grail of performance improvement, it really interests me. And despite anyone identifying systemic issues in the audit, Public Audit Audit Scotland used to do that regularly too, and point up and recommend and so on and so forth. But it did point to certain patterns within the public sector, but there it ended. So what I would like to ask you and get your thoughts on, when you do produce your reports and make recommendations, and even I would suggest even invite you to make recommendations for systemic improvement, but how on earth do we get systemic improvement back into the system? Because what's coming through is that you get something like 5,000 complaints a year, right? And you get 76% of them are dealt with within the period, and everybody's happy with that. But is it the same complaints that keep happening year on year elsewhere, so that the next 5,000 next year, it's the same stuff? So how do we get that improvement to go back into the system to really start to bring that sort of complaint tally down and really see improvement right across the public sector?
You're absolutely right. And it's one of the great frustrations that we see as well. Nicky will in a minute talk about our learning and improvement unit. What we're trying very hard to do is, through the limited information that we see, and remember, I only see complaints, I only see things that go wrong, is to try to enable each of the parts of the public service to work out how they can tackle these issues, so that, I think I've said to the committee before, you are the only committee in Europe that can see the local government complaints numbers for the whole of your country and take decisions about it. Nobody else has that information in the whole of Europe, only you. And one of the things that we're encouraging the Improvement Service and others to do is to get beyond the top level numbers here and look at the areas where complaints are being generated. Is it in housing? Is it in social work? Is it? And other common factors across that. Now, this committee is, I think, doing excellent work in trying to push benchmarking And I think this is an area where the benchmarking could work. Now, in order for us, we are a small organisation to try and help the whole of the public service in Scotland. We have a proposition which is currently going to the SPCB to staff a learning and improvement unit of two or three people in our office. And Mickey, would you like to just explain what that...
Yeah, I think just maybe to give a bit more context, I think that there are two issues here. So the first issue that Jim's talked about is about how you get that benchmarking information within each of the sectors, and Paul and colleagues have done an amazing job working with local authorities. So we now know there were 66,000 complaints across local authorities last year. And because you've got that data, as Jim says, you can really then start to drill down and to understand the problems. In terms of us as a service, we obviously see a very, very small percentage of those cases that then flow through to our office. But I think even then, given the low volumes, there are still opportunities to identify potentially systemic issues. It's hard to say because of the small volumes that we're dealing with. But the proposition is that we establish some form of learning and improvement unit. So at the moment, when we make recommendations, and you'll have seen this through the four cases that you looked into further, and you'll see the range of subjects, the range of the types of recommendations. And the recommendations can really be split into two parts. So the first part of recommendations is around addressing the personal injustice and hardship that's happened to that individual. And I think it's important to really remember that fundamentally that is what an ombudsman service is for. It is about getting personal justice for people. The second part is around improvement and learning. And I think that the quality of the recommendations that we make around that are really important. So what we want to do through the learning and improvement unit is to make sure that we, as far as possible, are consistent in our recommendations and as challenging in our recommendations in terms of driving improvement within the organisations that we're working with. And I think the situation... Yeah.
Because I think we get the gist of that. And, you know, what I would like to know here is you're talking about a new learning and improvement unit. It was mentioned during the course of that wee bit there, the improvement service. Are we talking about duplication here? Is it actually required, or is it just the fact that information should be passed to the improvement service to deal with a situation?
No,
I'll really play devil's advocate here. Yeah. Do we actually need an improvement service if you're going to carry out these kind of functions?
As I say, I think that they are two separate areas of work that we perform. We are obliged to make recommendations through our casework, and only we can do that. Only we have the statutory powers to do that. So what we need to do is, when we're making those recommendations, make sure that they're smart and they're challenging and that we're being consistent and that we are following through with organisations. We do that at the moment, but I think that what we would like to do is have a distinct part of the organisation that takes on that responsibility. I think the level of recommendations that we now make is 140% higher than back in 2010. So we're making significantly more recommendations. The work involved in following these recommendations is significant, and we think that we could do that in a smarter way.
Sorry, can I just for the record point out, the improvement service only operates within local government. That the whole of the public service in Scotland doesn't have an improvement service as local government does.
Not a can of worms there that I may falling into, Mr. Martin, because I could say something about that too, but we'll go on back to Mr. Coffey. Sorry, Willie.
Thanks very much. Thank you. What I was hoping to get a bit closer to was that when you come back next year, Jim, right, there, I'll guarantee there'll be another 5,000 complaints will have happened between now and then, just on the basis of the figures that you produce year on year. What I'm trying to get is, will that new service, the improvement service, really look at some of those systemic issues and try to get that kind of shared best practice or good practice, or whatever you want to call it, shared in the public sector to really try and get that down? Because if it doesn't, what's
I think that the answer is yes, we do that already. We, as you know, we share all of our findings, all of our recommendations already. But yes, we would hope that we can continue to drill down and to support organisations to use the information that they gather from complaints to learn.
Something didn't happen as a result of a recommendation. It's quite hard to do that, but you would begin to see, you would think that the volume dropping down, and you would hope to be able to attribute that to some of these interventions here. But I wonder if I can ask another question, convener. It was about
topic.
It's about the complaints process.
I wonder if we could stick with this improvement topic first, and I'll take you back in, Willie. Okay. Because I don't want to move away from from this improvement scenario. How, you know, you're talking about requiring, possibly requiring more powers, Mr. Martin. We're talking about the learning and improvement unit. How are you driving improvement at this moment in time with the powers and resources that you currently have at your disposal?
I'm glad you said powers and resources, convener, because we mustn't lose sight of the fact that in my organisation I have just under 50 people, that we have around 30 of these people who are working directly on individual complaints brought in. The complaint standards authority that we currently have is two people. My training unit is 0.6 of a person, and yet we're producing front-end training materials, e-learning materials, face-to-face training, which is being used in the whole of the National Health Service in Scotland, across all the local authorities in Scotland, and is even being used, I understand, in universities in Ireland and local authorities in New Zealand. We're trying very hard.
Universities in Ireland and
well,
New
convener,
Zealand.
Well, just as you didn't want me to go into improvement, I'm so glad you asked me that question. Because I've been banging on for about 3 years now that the fact that we're producing training materials, which are not licensed but are free to use by anyone else in other parts of the United Kingdom and abroad, is a missed opportunity by the Parliament to generate income which could subsidise the activities of my office. Now, I've made this point on numerous occasions in numerous places, and I'm so glad...
Not here.
I'm so glad, convener, you've given me the opportunity to raise it here as well. Thank you.
I think we may look into that, Mr. Martin. So could you expand, so in terms of with the current powers that you have, how you're driving improvement?
Well, remember, there are basically three things which I'm charged to do. One is to set up and look at complaints that are brought by individuals seeking remedy and who feel that they have an injustice. The second is through that work to do what I can to raise issues which will help to improve the provision of public services in Scotland. And the third, through the 2010 Act, is that I should monitor the handling of complaints and set forth a standardised complaints process for complaint handling across the public service in Scotland. So the second of these is much dependent on the other two activities. So that the improvements that we can suggest come out of the individual complaints that are brought to us, which takes us back to the systemic issue. So what we try to do with our recommendations is we try to make sure that we can push as far as we can that people take these recommendations seriously. Now, we were the first Ombudsman's Office in the public sector in the United Kingdom to publish our decisions. And every month we will publish between 60 and 70 decisions. And we will lay more serious reports, perhaps 3 or 4 individual reports directly before Parliament. We make these accessible, and we know that these are accessed by bodies across the public service in Scotland. What I don't have, and what I really don't want to become, I don't want to become the improvement unit for the public service in Scotland. But what I want to do is to use the experiences of the people that come to us where things have gone wrong to help public bodies think about the provisions that they are making. And with the limited resources we have, we try to do our best to do that.
Okay. We may come back to that. Mr. Coffey, please. Sorry.
Thanks very much, Convener. I was picking up on your point about the NHS complaints process being brought more into line with the rest of the public sector. But is it still the case that complaints processes that people have to engage with are by and large pretty different. Right? I mean, if you look, for example, at local authorities, NHS, police, fire, or anything else, it's a different kind of system they have to interact with each time, is it? Or are we trying to get a consistent, consolidated experience for the public so that they have to complain in the same way no matter who they want to complain about?
The 2010 Act that we work under charged me with putting in place a standardised complaints process across all the bodies for which I'm responsible as Ombudsman. And we are by and large there. The last part of that is the NHS, and I'll ask Paul to tell you where we're going with that. Police does not, and I speak as an ex-police complaints commissioner, does not fall under my responsibilities, and nor should it, and I'm happy to discuss that any time. But by and large, the aim is to get as many organisations as possible in the public service in Scotland operating on a simple, standardised process so that the ordinary person in the street knows how to access things and that things are accessed and resolved as quickly as possible. That's the aim. And I'm glad that the NHS has now decided to go down that route as well, and we're making substantial progress there.
We are. I think in terms of NHS, I think that a lot of good work was undertaken in terms of complaints handling on the back of the Patients' Rights Act and all the supporting legislation and work that went around that. I think there are some differences. Well, there are some differences there between the process and the way of handling complaints in that sector compared to where we've gone in other sectors. I think one of the crucial differences is that the emphasis on early local resolution close to the front line at that point of service delivery is something that hasn't really worked in NHS, and I think that's one of the key areas that we are working with NHS to implement. So in local authorities, for example, we now know that we have over 80% of complaints resolved at that front line or close to that front line in 5 or 10 days in a very quick timescale. We want to get the NHS to that point. I think bringing the NHS into line with where we are with our sectors, our standard process, not just in terms of timescales and stages, but also the kind of governance mechanisms that are in there and how they report and what they report, is the work that we are continuing with the NHS stakeholders and progressing very well.
Chris, do you kind of routinely consider material that comes from Audit Scotland in terms of there to get this big picture, this global picture of issues that are going on? I know you were saying you're restricted in your ability to investigate in a systemic way, but certainly you can consider messages that are coming from various Audit Scotland reports, for example. Do you do that? Do you do that as part of your work too?
We speak very often with Audit Scotland, the Accounts Commission, Healthcare Improvement Scotland, the Prisons Inspector. We across the various different sectors, including the water regulator, we have discussions about what we're finding, what they're finding, and we try to feed in. So that, for example, when Healthcare Improvement Scotland undertook an investigation into Aberdeen, I think it's at Royal Infirmary, that they went into, one of the things that we did was we worked with them to devise a tool which would enable them to work out how efficiently the Grampian Health Board and Aberdeen Royal Infirmary were handling complaints at that time to help inform Healthcare Improvement Scotland's decisions at the end of the day of their investigation and their inquiry. So we will work with other agencies as much as we can.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Okay, Molly. Can I ask you, Mr. Martin, what, if any, consideration is given to determining from the outset a wider public benefit that could arise from an investigation?
You have to remember that when a complaint comes to us, it comes as an individual who's had a poor experience with a public body. And in the course of that investigation, many different things might arise. It might be a simple thing, where someone comes, for example, saying that their council tax has been miscalculated or whatever, and we can resolve that very quickly. Sometimes it can be more complex. And sometimes, very rarely, but sometimes things will have a broader implication. These would be flagged up to me as the investigation was going on. One of the things, for example, a work-a-day thing, if every case which comes into my office and into the SPSO which involves a death or a vulnerable person, I'll be informed immediately that that's in the building. So that would then enable us to say, you know, we've looked at the circumstances of this. We want to see that one looked at a bit more depth initially, or we want that fast-tracked. I saw one yesterday which pertains to the treatment of a child in an infirmary, and we want that fast-tracked. When it comes to general public policy improvement, that is something that once we've been through an investigation, be a judgment for me to take at that, whether it's something that's broader than just the individual complaint or it's something that has a wider implication. But again, convener, I'm restricted to looking at the individual complaint. I mean, I'm not supposed to look at other complaints that come through, but, you know, the way of the world, you do these things.
Okay. So what do you consider to be the added value of investigating cases solely to recognise the validity of the person's complaint to be, and what consideration is given to the implications for those being investigated?
Do you want to do that?
Yeah, I think when we look at cases, what we do is we consider the proportionality of the investigation of that case. So, for example, we look at whether or not we can actually achieve a practical outcome for someone that's over and above what they've already had. So, in an example where we felt that a body has already carried out a thorough investigation, they've made comprehensive recommendations and they've implemented those recommendations, and we feel that it's actually not possible for us to, or practical for us to go beyond that, we wouldn't progress that case any further. And I think we are mindful of the impact that our investigations have on the bodies that we investigate.
So if you feel that everything possible has been done by the body, you wouldn't take that any further?
No.
And you would communicate with the complainer as soon as given your reasons?
Yes.
Why you're not taking that any further. Mr. McFadden, you look like you were wanting to come in there. No? Okay, I'm misreading body language today. And in terms of that communication, which we've talked about on many occasions when you've been in front of this committee, do you think that you are better communicating with complainers about your reasoning for maybe not pursuing a complaint communicating with them about the recommendations that you're making, which they may not think is the right ones?
I think that we do a lot of work with our staff to support good communication skills. We have clear service standards that we operate to. I think that in giving decisions, we do that as far as we can over the telephone. What we try to do is give people assurance that the body has done everything that they should and could have done. But ultimately, I think people will feel often that case should have been investigated. And I think that all you can do in those circumstances is give very clear explanation and assurance as far as you possibly can.
Can I just add, there is a flip side to this, convener, please. I don't know if this is informing your question. Very often public bodies will say to me, but we've already upheld that complaint. Why are you investigating it? And there are a number of reasons where we might do that. One is that, you know, the complainant might not be happy with the outcome which has come. That what has been upheld might not be the entirety of what the person was complaining about. Or that we're just not convinced that a full investigation has actually taken place. If I give you an example, I recently had a case. Sorry, I'm using health cases because this is the local government
committee. Feel free to use whatever cases you think are the best.
I'll use a health case. We had a case which someone had made a complaint. It was about the death of someone during an operation. And they complained to the health board about how the operation was conducted. They'd investigated it, and they had said that they were satisfied that the surgeon involved had acted appropriately. And I think it had also been looked at by the fisco. What the complainant wanted to know was, not had the surgeon performed his duties appropriately, but was the operation carried out appropriately? And when we investigated that, we found a couple of things. We found errors by an anaesthetist. And we found that the relationship within the operating theatre at the time that the operation was being conducted was at best described as dysfunctional. Now, none of these issues had been looked at by the board or by the fiscal. So technically, the board saying, you know, well, one or two things might have gone wrong, we uphold part of it. We felt we should look at the rest of what happened. We looked at that. We found learning points for the board. We found learning points for the anaesthetist. And we found we were able to give the complainant some comfort. So we will not just automatically assume because a public body says to us, we have upheld this, you shouldn't look at it. We will have a good look at what the complainant's saying to us and determine whether there's something still there to be looked at.
Okay. In terms of your own efficiency and effectiveness as an organisation, we have had a look at four complaints around about that. One from Glasgow University comments on the potential effects that the time taken to investigate could have had for the complainer. How can you improve in your own efficiency in dealing with these things, Timiously?
I think that we've submitted evidence previously to this committee and again this year in terms of the increasing efficiency in case closure rates. So I think that within the resources that we have available, we have clearly demonstrated a history of improving efficiency. I think that the gains that we can now make are in supporting and encouraging the bodies that we work with to improve in their own efficiency and handling of cases so that when complainants do come to us, we receive clear, well-documented complaints investigations that make it easier for us to reach quicker decisions.
If I were unhappy about the length of time that you are taking to investigate my case, what's my redress?
You'd approach me and I would look at it, Convener. I'm not happy about the time we take to look at some of our cases. No one would be. In our defence, if we need to defend ourselves, we are probably the most efficient public service ombudsman body operating in the UK. We, for example, we will measure the amount of time that we have cases in our building by the minute it arrives. All our comparable offices, to my knowledge, only start the clock once they have had all the paperwork and all the information they need to begin an investigation. We take the view that the time that's important here is the time that the individual is spending with us, not the time that we are taking to deal with the case. I've said to the committee every year that I've come here that the increasing complexity of cases, particularly in health, are putting a real strain on our organisation. This year, for the first time, I think, since 2002, we've had a reasonably significant drop in the number of complaints coming through our door in the first 9 months of the year. I think we're down 4.5% or something. That's the first time. Even allowing for that, we've had a 41% increase in the number of cases coming to our office on the 2009-10 numbers, and our staffing is virtually the same. So that what we try to do is to use the resources we have as efficiently as we possibly can. Now, when it gets into looking into matters which require a great deal of investigation, sometimes we're in the hands of the public body. Sometimes we need to get advice from people. At all times, we try to make sure that we put the interests of the person who's brought the complaint to us as our first priority. But inevitably, with the volume of complaints we have and the number of staff that we have, some of these complaints are going to take a long time.
In terms of not repeat complaints from individuals, but issues which are repetitive in terms of complaints, are there a huge amount of issues where, you know, there are repeat complaints on that particular subject?
There are a number.
Which areas are those, Mr. Martin?
I'll come to that in a second. It's one of the reasons why we want this learning and improvement unit to operate, so that we can flag these up and have the bodies concerned deal with them. You'll find similar cases will arise in planning. You'll find that in housing association, waits for repairs will be an issue. You'll find in some housing associations that the quality of repairs will be an issue. When I first came into office here, the thing that struck me most was the number of cases in health boards we had around bed sores and pressure ulcers. In each of the sectors, you will find that there are areas which continually repeat. In prisons, it tends to be progression or training courses. And what we try to do is we try to engage with the public bodies and say, look, this is what we are seeing. These are coming through. You need to try and get a hold of these.
These things keep reoccurring in the same areas.
Yeah.
It doesn't really show that you're being effective in terms of getting the message out there that these public bodies need to improve in these areas, does it?
That's why we're looking at this learning and improvement unit, why we're engaging with bodies up and down the country in all of the sectors. We are, I can sense the frustration behind your question, Convener. It's nothing compared to mine. Absolutely nothing compared to mine.
I thought earlier during the course of the budgetary examination of that decisive shift to prevention that the government has been looking for in almost every area. And when I say prevention, I'm not just talking about in terms of health. In terms of what you're describing, there doesn't seem to be very many lessons learned in certain areas from your previous findings, which would of course lead to that decisive shift to prevention and less complaints coming into your office.
Well, I think you must remember what we're looking at. We're looking at the tip of the complaints iceberg is what we are seeing. So we're flagging up, we are engaging, we are trying to find ways of working in partnership with organisations. If I give you an example, we reckoned that something like 40-45% of all the cases coming to our office were coming from around 10 or 12 different organisations only, of the whole of the public sector. So we began to engage with these organisations individually. And we said to them, there are a number of things that put you into that group. The number of premature complaints coming to us, that's people who are coming to us when they should go to you, is too high. The number of upholds that we have is too high compared with the rest of your sector, and the volumes are not the volumes we would expect to see. And we begin to engage with these. So that, for example, with Lothian Health Board, we sat down with them and said, your volumes are too high, your upholds are too high, your prematures are too high, and we're not convinced you're actually investigating complaints properly. And what that has done is allowed them to revise the way that they do things. You have to remember that we sit here as an ombudsman office, and that the very fact that we're an ombudsman office means that we flag things, we can try and push things, but what we don't have is a big stick to make people do things.
Stop you there, because you know, I'm a bit of an anorak when it comes to your reports, and I kind of say that I read them all, because that would not be the case, but yeah, I read a fair bit of them. But you're talking about a number of organisations who, you know, seem to be the perpetual difficulty for yourself. Where in the annual report is that information available to me and to members of the public? And if that were available in the annual report, why is it so difficult to find?
It's not something that we put into the annual report, but all the figures about...
Why not?
I think it's around something that we've spoken about previously at this committee, that we don't feel that we wish to name and shame.
I'm sorry, I'm going to stop you there, because, you know, we've... earlier on, we've talked about the interventions that this committee has taken to try and resolve difficulties. Now, it is impossible for any one of us to track all of the cases that we get sent to us. That would just be an impossibility. So what would be very useful for us, and I would say that the annual report would be the place to do it, is to actually highlight the organisations that are causing difficulties so that either this committee can take interventions or other committees of the Parliament can take interventions. And, you know, in terms of effectiveness, which we've already touched upon as well, and that decisive shift to prevention, we really need to have that information in one place, simplified, so that we can actually move forward to try and create better services for the general public. So I would ask, can we have that in the annual report? And, you know, in terms of this, we don't want to name and shame. Well, we're never going to improve situations unless we know which organisations are causing you the most difficulty.
Can I put a little bit of context into my response?
Yeah.
We do provide on an annual basis, as I think the committee knows, and we put it into our briefing, statistics about every organisation about which we've received complaints, the subject of the complaint, whether we upheld it or not. And in addition to that, we provide on an annual basis a letter with detailed statistics about each organisation, with comparisons of their statistics with other organisations, the premature rates and the uphold rates and the subjects. So it is possible for anyone to look at all of the information that's in the public domain and do analysis in order to ascertain what it is that they're wishing to find out.
Ms Gray, it is very difficult to find the time to deal with every aspect of this life, it has to be said. And I don't think that anybody around this table would have the time to complete the analysis that you are talking about. But beyond that, in terms of the numbers and the tables that are provided in the annual report, but also in other material that you produce, it tells me, or it tells members, very little about what those complaints are. And they could be the most simplistic thing under the sun, or they could be the most severe thing. There could be a smattering of one-off cases in an organisation which have no connection whatsoever in those statistics, or they may all be the same, a complaint about the same thing. We cannot analyse that, and that's why, you know, what we require is something which helps us get to the point where, you know, we can say, ah, here we go. We actually require an intervention here to try and improve the situation for the public. As it stands at the moment, we're unable to do that from the information that we get.
That's a way to think about it.
If you could, Mr. Martin.
The reason I say that, not yes, we'll do it, no, we'll not do it, is you just said all the things that I think I was about to say. There's a difference between raw data and raw league tables and qualitative issues. For example, in these 10 or 11, whatever it was, 12 organisations that we had, there are one or two that you would expect to be there. You would expect Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board to be there because it's a health board that has got huge volumes, so you'd expect it to be in there. It's the outliers which fall into that area which worry me more. So if, for example, a smaller health board finds itself in our top 10, then I'm asking myself, well, why is that? So if you just let me take away and think about what qualitative information might be useful for the committee rather than just bombard you with raw statistics, that might be more useful. But I'm happy to liaise with the clerk on what you think would be useful.
I think that would be extremely useful. And I really do think that, you know, there should be some simple way of dealing with that issue in the annual report, so that not only this committee can pick up on it, but other interested parties can also pick up on it too. Are there any other questions from committee members? No. In which case, can I thank you for your evidence today? I think the clerks will be in touch, and we hope to hear from you in some of the matters that we have raised. I suspend and we move into private session. Thank you.